So I apologize for the change of title. So as research goes, there was something more interesting to talk about. So we are connecting continuum and Monte Carlo results in this talk. So the idea is something that we have heard before when we constrained cosmic parameters from various data sources like baryon acoustic oscillation or supernova data. We want to do quantum gravity and we want to get insights from two different programs. So continuum beam one program and Monte Carlo simulations, the other program. So, brief outline of the talk. Let me spend a few words explaining what we mean by asymptotic safety. Then there will be a picture show showing gravitational randomization group flows on various backgrounds. So we worked on cosmic backgrounds and we worked on compact backgrounds. And in the end, I will hopefully explain how this fits together in various approaches. So what we have seen in this talk, in various talks, so we have a highly successful theory of gravity, general relativity, and this has allowed us to explain many interesting phenomena. So cosmological models can explain the flatness of the horizon. We have seen the detection of gravitational waves. We have heard quite a lot about this. So here we are extremely successful. The point where we are not so successful is combining general relativity with the laws of quantum mechanics. So the naive starting point to go about this program could be as follows. So we could start from the Einstein-Hilbert action, and then we apply the same laws of quantization that work for the other forces. And then we see, it doesn't quite work. So at one loop, you can still get away with the quantization procedure, but at two loops, you encounter the following divergence. So here we have the Weyl tensor. You see this is a term which contains Weyl cubed. This is not of the form of the initial action, so you cannot reabsorb this divergence in a redefinition of Newton's constant. So then, what could you do? Well, you can add the c squared term to your initial action. This will introduce a new free parameter, and this is the onset of trouble. So in general, it is expected that this is only the first counter term that appears in this series. So you will probably need an infinite number of them, and this is the statement that general relativity is a perturbatively non-randomizable theory. Okay, we can cast this into a different form. So what actually is the source of the trouble is the mass dimension of Newton's constant. So if you do a dimensional analysis of this expression, you find that this guy has negative mass dimension. Then you can check with field theories that are actually perturbatively randomizable, and then you find that they share the property that all the coupling constants have either zero or positive mass dimensions. So this is what makes this action different from usual textbook quantization. And then you can relate this to a modern formulation of randomization. So here we understand that if a theory is randomizable, it's associated to its fixed point structure. If it's asymptotically free, it will go to a free field fixed point at the UV. And then you can check that if you have a negative mass dimension sitting around, your theory will never go to the Gaussian fixed point. You will just be driven away from this fixed point just because the classical mass dimension will dominate the flow for small coupling. So this is the same statement as we had before. General relativity is not asymptotically free or randomizable. So where to go from here? So common folklore is that general relativity still works as an effective field theory. So it should be good as long as our energy scales are below the Planck scale. So we can systematically compute quantum corrections in this regime, and we have predictive power there. This probably goes wrong if you look at processes with energies comparable to the Planck scale, so then you need to determine an infinite number of coupling constants by experiment. You can say, okay, maybe we should go for new physics. We also heard talks on this. So string theory being one option, we also heard talks about loop quantum gravity. Asymptotic safety takes a different take on this story. So the conjecture is that gravity still makes sense as a quantum field theory. So the failure is not in quantum field theory per se, so it's a failure of perturbation theory. So we are looking for a non-perturbative UV completion of the theory. And this will set the topic of the talk. So the asymptotic safety package, what do we need? So first we need a fixed point of our RG flow, which controls the theory at very high energies. So in this way we can get rid of UV divergences. Then we want to construction to be predictive. This is encoded in the properties of this fixed point. So essentially we want to have a situation where only a finite dimensional set of RG trajectories approaches the fixed point as we go to very high energies. So then we can pinpoint the trajectory in the surface by doing a finite number of measurements, and from that we can predict actually an infinite number of coupling constants. We also want the theory to be connected to observable low energy physics. So in essence, we want to be able to reproduce tests of general relativity of the gravitational side, and we want the theory be compatible with observations that we made in the matter sector, especially in the standard model. And then finally, we also had a heated discussion about this. So there could also be some structural demands and unitarity and the shape of the propagator. So this is what we discussed already during this workshop. So now, having the switch list, we need to have a tool to actually do computations. The starting point is path integral over matrix. Now, this is a highly untraceable thing. So what the randomization group does, it starts from this path integral, it adds a regulating term to it. So this guy here adds a mass term to fluctuation modes with momentum p squared smaller than k squared. And then we can massage this expression from a path integral to a functional differential equation. So essentially what we have here on the left-hand side, this is called defective average action, and this equation tells us how the corresponding expression changes if we integrate out quantum fluctuations. Now one should appreciate that this equation is far better behaved than the actual path integral that we started out with. So on the left-hand side we only get contributions from small momentum shells in fluctuations, so we are dealing with a finite quantity here, so the flow is well defined. Also, fundamental actions appear as initial conditions, so we don't need to specify this S that appears up here a priori. So, in this case, when we do this modification to the path integral, we integrate out quantum fluctuations shell by shell, and in this way, we realize Wilsonian randomization group flows. Okay, this is the first half of the story. What else could I do? I can start from the same path integral, and instead of introducing the regulator, I can also discretize the geometry that I'm dealing with. So in essence, I evaluate this partition sum on building blocks. So here, these are triangles in the simplest case, and my geometry will appear from gluing together these triangles. This is also a path that had been taken by the community. So you make this integral here into a sum over possible configurations. There are two versions of this. So Euclidean triangulations admit all triangulations in the sum of the partition sum, and causal dynamical triangulations restricts the sum to a subset. So essentially what you do here is you impose a foliation structure on spacetime. So clearly the same starting point up here should tell you that what you do get out down here should be related in some way. So then let's have a quick look at results that have been obtained. So the simple evaluation that you can do in terms of flow equations uses the Einstein-Hilbert action. You have two coupling constants, G and lambda, which can depend on the scale. You substitute this into your ansatz. You solve the corresponding equation. You project it onto the subspace. And then you get beta functions which tell you how your coupling constants change with energy. Now, first thing, we are interested in the fixed point structure of this equation. We get a Gaussian fixed point which corresponds to the free field theory. This is the one that we have seen at the beginning of the talk, but it turns out that there is also a non-Gaussian fixed point. This is UV attractive for both of our coupling constants, so this would be a fixed point that is actually suitable for asymptotic safety and could be the UV completion of your theory. You can integrate this equation, so this was already done a long time ago. So here we have dimensionless Newton's coupling, here's the dimensionless cosmological constant. If you restrict to positive Newton's constant, you are up here. You see there's an interplay between two fixed points, the Gaussian fixed point here, non-Gaussian fixed point here. All flows emanate from this non-Gaussian fixed point. They go to smaller energies. And the things that go down here to the Gaussian fixed point regime develop something like a classical GR regime. So here on this side, we have a positive cosmological constant. Here is a negative cosmological constant. And here we get something that has zero cosmological constant. There has been a lot of activity in the program, so we have heard various talks about it. So Alessia Platania talked about applications of asymptotic safety to black holes. And also, I should stress that the mechanism is not limited to gravity, so it also works if matter fields are present. So in particular, there is evidence that a similar non-Gaussian fixed point also appears if we add the standard model matter content to the construction. Highlighting some results from the causal dynamical triangulations, also these guys were able to construct a phase diagram. Here's the cartoon version, so they have two parameters which span the diagram. They obtain three phases. Here we have something in phase C that resembles a classical universe. Here, these are pancake universes. They have no time extension. And here we have oscillatory universes. And assessment is our universe lives in this phase C. They also provided some data, like they can measure their geometries. And here they have profile functions, volume in a spatial slice. Then you see, if you do a simulation restricting the background to be of the topology of a sphere S1, this corresponds to time times a closed 3 sphere, then you get a nice Gaussian curve. So this tells you that your geometry is essentially a 4 sphere. They also did simulations with this background, and you see, you also get a classical geometry from this one. Now the question is, can we get this also from the phase diagram that we constructed from the RG flow? So from CDT, we learned that foliation structures are quite important. So let's copy this idea and set up an RG equation which is tailored to the presence of a foliation. So in the continuum, that means we are resorting to an ADM formalism. So we build up our space-time in stacks of spatial slices, and we weld them together by a lapse and a shift function. So Essentially, what we want to do is we encode our gravitational degrees of freedom in ellipse, a shift, and a spatial metric. So this is the same construction that is used in numerical relativity. Then we declare these are our fundamental fields that we have to encode our gravitational degrees of freedom. We split them into background fields plus fluctuation fields. There is some choices involved. And what we see is if we apply this parametrization of the fluctuations, then this is a refinement of the standard exponential parametrization. So in this case, we can preserve the signature of space and time directions independently. So once this choice is made, one can go through the standard derivation of the flow equation. It takes the same form. So here, this trace takes care about all these fields. Now, let's evaluate the sky on a cosmical background. The ansatz that we had before is again Einstein-Hilbert, now written in the ADM variables. Then there's the extrinsic and intrinsic curvature appearing here. We choose our background to be a cosmic background of Friedmann, Lemaître, Robertson, Walker type. This is given here. And we parameterize our fluctuations around this background in the standard way used in cosmic perturbation theory. Then we are instructed to construct the propagators on this background, and then we see, oh, something is wrong. So these are not the standard propagators that you know from field theory in flat space. So here you are missing spatial momenta. Here is a strange combination of space and time derivatives. So something is very strange here. Now, wait a minute. We forget to add some gauge fixing terms. So let's gauge fix the theory, adding these terms. And then you see, with choosing and proper gauge fixing, you can get a Hessian which propagates all the fields in a standard way. So this is crucial, and by demanding that all fields have a standard propagator in a flat background, this fixes your gauge fixing uniquely. So after dealing with this, we have a well-defined Hessian, and we can actually substitute this ansatz in flow equation and evaluate. Here is the result in terms of diagrams. It looks strikingly similar to the one that we had in the standard covariant computation. So again, we have a non-Gaussian fixed point, a Gaussian fixed point, and the types of flows that we have seen before. Now, this is the demonstration. This is the same flow diagram. The difference is that here we also included all the matter fields of the standard model. What you see is the non-Gaussian fixed point shifted a little bit. Also, its critical exponent changed from complex to real. But otherwise, the structure of the flow is exactly the same that we had before. So asymptotic safety could also be an option for the standard model coupled to gravity. Now, the main part in terms of CDT investigations used the background S1 times SD. So we decided to check what happens if we change this background in terms of flow equations. The setup is the same. We only need to change the reparametrization of our fluctuation fields. So we adjust it to the background sphere. In this case, again, there's a unique gauge fixing, which leads to well-defined propagators. And you can construct the same type of flow diagrams. So here we have different parametrizations of the fluctuations. Again, the thing looks strikingly similar to what we had before, with the exception of the diagram that we have down here. So let's zoom into this particular case. So there was something special happening. So instead of the red singularity that we had before in this corner, we now have a second fixed point of the flow. Also, this singularity has been shifted upward. So now we have a behavior of the flow coming from this fixed point, going here, developing a positive cosmological constant. But then in the end, it's guided by this connection line into this last point, C. At this level, this looks fairly innocent. But let's convert this story to dimensionful parameters. So let's go to this corner and look what Newton's constant and the cosmological constant in this corner do. So here I have my energy scale, the randomization group scale. Here is the cosmological constant. Here is dimensionful Newton's constant. You start see at very high energies, you have the non-Gaussian fixed point. As intermediate energies, there is a plateau. So this is where general relativity lives. And then if we go to Hubble horizon scales, you see there's a new phase setting in, and the cosmological constant wants to go to zero dynamically. So let me be careful here. I call it infrared completion. Other ones call this mechanism erasing the cosmological constant by graviton instabilities. So there has been a recent paper on that, but the mechanism has been known for 15 years. So now, seeing that at the level of randomization groups, the choice of background didn't really matter, where are the profiles that have been encountered in CDT? So can we do the relation? The answer is we should look at self-consistent backgrounds. So it's not encoded in the RG flow. What we are instructed to look at are the equations of motion. And we look at the equations of motion of the effective action. So essentially what you hear construct are backgrounds where the expectation value of your fluctuations vanish. Then you can do this for endpoints of two different sets of trajectories. So we had the trajectories which had a positive cosmological constant. Here we recover precisely the corresponding volume profile that we had in the CDT phase C. And if we've construct the solutions for a type 2A trajectory, we get precisely the straight line that has been also been recovered in CDT. So in this way, we understand how these profiles arise in terms of the flow equation. And we can use information on this peak structure to actually tell where we are in phase space. And also, I should stress that this one doesn't have any knowledge about the background where the RG flow was computed. So this works quite general. So now this gives a map between phases that are seen in the Monte Carlo and the phases that we have in the functional randomization group. Naturally, we can use this map to learn about other quantities. So what is still on the agenda is look at correlation functions in fluctuations in the three volume. So what we already understand is that from this we can determine the renormalized value of Newton's constant. So here we have the first systematic relation between Monte Carlo simulations and continuum approaches to quantum gravity. This brings me to the conclusion. So, since we are already at the end of the conference and tired, let's be brief. I like the idea of having bumper stickers in a certain talk. So I formulated my conclusions in terms of bumper stickers. So first, gravity rules. So we can study asymptotic safety restricting to just the gravitational sector. And this is the best explored area. If we want to connect to the physical world, there's no way we can avoid including matter in the construction. So there has been a lot of progress in understanding this part, and it looks quite promising. then given that my time is finite, I don't have to prove to you that time is essential. So this picks up the spirit of the talk. Thank you.